thank you so much for inviting me to participate, and congratulations on the center. Please allow me to share my screen and let's get started. Let me start by observing that advances in AI and autonomy have the potential to make a huge impact on transportation. For example, in a single year, Americans drive nearly 3 trillion miles. And if you average that at 60 miles an hour, that adds up to many billions of hours spent in the car. And of course, this number grows exponentially as we consider the rest of the globe. So imagine if we can bring extensive capabilities to our cars so that they can become our trusted partners. What if cars can learn how we drive, how to never engage in an accident, how to never cause a collision? What if they could really become trusted partners? And so these are the questions that have been on our minds in our project on autonomous transportation at MIT. Now, as I think about autonomy in transportation, I observe that there is a huge amount of uncertainty in driving. And to make progress, we have to consider several parameters as we think about the possibilities for advancing what cars can do safely. And these parameters have to do with how complex is the environment where the car moves, and how complex are the interactions between the cars and the environment. In other words, what are the underlying questions that enable cars to cope with these uncertainties? So we already have deployable solutions for cars that move slowly in low complexity environments, as you can see from this deployment that goes back to 2012. But sensors don't work well in weather, and the uncertainty of the perception system increases significantly if it rains hard or if it snows. And so that is a challenge. Additionally, the uncertainty of the vehicle prior increases significantly in the case of extreme congestion with vehicles, people, scooters, and even cows, as you see in this video I took in Bangalore on a recent trip there. And so there are many important preconditions, many of which revolve around uncertainty in perception, uncertainty in planning, uncertainty in reasoning and execution before we get to the goal of safe robot taxi. And today I would like to highlight a few research directions that we have been exploring. The first one is about how we get self-driving vehicles to have more complex capabilities in more complex environments. How can we incorporate risk in the control loop of a vehicle? And how can we handle congestion and interaction with human-driven cars? Let me get started. Let me observe that if we take a step back and look at a traditional autonomous vehicle pipeline, the key idea is to break up the problem and solve several sub-problems, mainly about safe sensor fusion to address what is happening around me, obstacle detection, where are the obstacles and what are they doing, to figure out where the vehicle is relative to the obstacles, then to figure out where to go and how to execute that. Now, in practice, this approach is difficult to follow since it requires hand engineering of the connections between these modules, and it requires hand engineering of the parameterization for these modules. And so, for instance, if the luminosity changes, if you have different types of lane markings, if you have harsh weather conditions, all these have to be adjusted and parameterized manually for each module. And so our team has approached this problem in an alternative way. So we have solved the first architecture, and then we have asked ourselves whether it is possible to create an end-to-end learning system that combines the inner modules of the pipeline into one algorithm one algorithm that learns directly from sensor data how to steer. And in particular, this could be done by watching how humans steer. And so with that in mind, we have created a system where we have raw perception from cameras installed on the dashboard of the vehicle and from a coarse map. Now, this is not the same as the high definition maps used by autonomous vehicles. You can think of this as a kind of a line drawing or the same topological map that people follow when they drive. And so from this input, we are able to compute a continuous probability function that gives us a map between what the environment looks like and how we might want to steer, and also where we're located in the environment. We can formulate this as an end-to-end neural network system, where the first part, what you see at the top of the slide, captures all the different probabilities for turning or for steering. And the second part adds the feedback from the map to help the vehicle localize within the environment. And so together we are able to create an end-to-end navigation system that is able to even generalize to new types of road configurations for which the system has not been trained. For example, our system trained to drive with Cambridge area example drives is able to go around roundabouts which are not present in our data set. And furthermore, because we are creating this continuous probability distribution different possibilities, our system is also able to differentiate well in advance between different types of road situations. So for instance, if you look at this example of an intersection, you might see as a human, you might see that there are some lines on the road, there is a stop sign. And so if I ask you what type of intersection might there be, given a multitude of intersection types, you might have a good guess. Well, we can capture the same kind of notion through our probabilistic modeling to see that, in fact, in this case, the highest probability would be a cross intersection. This notion of associating specific probabilities with different types of actions, different types of outcomes can be used to train a system in one environment and then have it execute in a completely different environment. And so here's an example of our vehicle that has been trained in an urban area and is now taking a first drive in an environment it has not seen before, that you can see is rural. It doesn't really look like urban driving. So the system can follow directions, it navigates its way through intersections, and it's able to recognize that it has arrived at the goal. So I wanted to look inside our machine learning engine for this system. And what you see in this video is a few small boxes that capture the convolutional layers used to process the input, the images that arrive in the system. And what you see in the middle, the big rectangular box with blinking yellow, green, and blue lights, is the reasoning engine that that tells the system what to do. And you can see that it's a little bit of a mess. It's very complex to associate patterns with decisions. This system has over 100,000 neurons, and you see their activity captured in this rectangular box. You can see in the lower right corner the map as the vehicle travels through the environment, and in the lower left corner you see the attention map. This captures where the network looks in order to make its decision, and you see that the attention map is sort of all over the place. It's not quite clear which parts of the image are used to make this decision. So we've been wanting to do better than this in building such safety critical systems. And the idea we explored is called neural circuit policies. The idea is inspired by the neural architecture of earthworms. So biologists have mapped the neural system of an earthworm. The system has 300 neurons, and it's known that each neuron computes a differential equation, and it's known that there are specialized neurons that have different roles in the life of an earthworm. So it's really quite remarkable that an earthworm lives, finds food, finds a mate, entertains itself all with 300 neurons. So can we have machine learning systems that operate with the same level of compactness? And indeed, we have been able to map our 100 plus thousand node network into a 19 node neural network that has the same function as the original end-to-end system. And the secret idea is to replace the function of each neuron from a step function to a differential equation. And so going back to our end-to-end driving here, you can see the solution now implemented in this much more compacted form with these 19 more powerful networks. The convolutional layers process the image, they stay the same. The reasoning part is in the middle. And now as you watch how the neurons fire and what the vehicle does along the road, it's much more clear what the associations between the reasoning engine and the execution look like. And also, I would like to call your attention to the attention map, where now you can see that this neural network is looking not all over the image, but the focus is on the horizon and on the side of the road. So we feel very encouraged by the possibility of using this type of approach to leverage the benefits we get from data-driven methods, but to do so in a way that is more compact and that has more potential for understanding. Now we know that networks do as well as the data used to train them. And in the case of safety critical applications, the question is how can you provide data to these networks that captures near misses or that captures crashes and accidents? And so in order to do that, we have explored a line of research where we are looking at whether it is possible to train the network in simulation using reinforcement learning, using some real physical data and some data derived from that physical data that might capture more erratic driving, that might capture the near misses. And then to get to the point where we can map that body of learning, that model directly from simulation to a physical model. So what we do effectively is we take a path, we have a high definition trajectory, and then in simulation, we can generate a lot of variants of this trajectory. And this addresses a lot of the limitations of the current model-based approaches to simulation, where we either lack photorealism or it's not possible to do the direct transfer between two domains, or we don't have enough scalability. And so the approach is like this. We take one high definition data set, and then we are able to transform this data set from this high definition data set into a variety of trajectories that might oscillate, that might even lead to crashes. And so here you can see that we might even be able to change the viewpoint. You can see in the green box how the world looks different depending on where the car is on the road. And here we are in simulation modeling a wavy, erratic driving trajectory. This allows us to extend our end-to-end network to capture this kind of training and to test this training directly from simulation to the physical world. But first, we have compared our method with the existing literature. And here in this slide, you can see in red dots, we can see intervention and crash points from the previous methods. And our method is shown on the right. And we can also see the trajectory variance across these methods. So we're pretty excited about using this approach. In this video, you see a direct deployment from simulation to real world situation without any adjustments. And the charts on the slide demonstrate superior robustness to recovering from challenging off orientations. As you can see, being too far on the side of the road or being pointed in the wrong direction. So we're very excited about the possibility of using these approaches to create networks with increasingly better capabilities. Let me say a few quick words about how we might deal with clutter and with other high complexity interaction. And so clutter is challenging if you try to identify exactly what are all the objects and what they're doing, because imaging techniques will have trouble if you have clusters indoors, even if you have these tables with long feet, they're often recognized as people. If you have someone dragging things like a suitcase, all of these confuse the physical detectors. And so what we have explored is a method that, instead of trying to identify what the individual's objects are, we want to associate what the general movement flow is in the scene. And to do so, we define safety nets around vehicles. And then we create risk level sets associated with these safety nets. So the input is position estimates and velocities. We assume that agents are self-preserving and they continue movement in the current direction. And we create an output cost, which we call the risk level set. And then given this risk level set, we can adjust parameters for the control function to respond to conservative or addressing or aggressive driving. So here you can see the dynamic risk density sets might look like, and how we can capture some global movement properties of the world rather than identifying individual vehicles. And so here you can see a simulation of this approach using a conservative risk function. And so in this case, the blue car, which we're controlling, essentially gets into one lane, and the gray areas are no drive areas as indicated by the cost function. And you can see that the car does not do very much beyond moving in the lane. Now, if the car has a higher risk tolerance, you can see that there are many more lane changes, and you can see the no drive gray areas are smaller, occupy less of the environment. So we think that modeling this notion of risk in the context of how vehicles drive can give us finer granularity for describing autonomy. And we can take this idea and apply it from controlling a single vehicle to controlling multiple vehicles as they drive in increasingly more congested environments. And so there is much more work left to be done, but we see this as a promising direction. We can even apply this idea to movement in a pedestrian space, where here you can see an autonomous robotic wheelchair that responds in real time to fairly high level of congestion in the space, and you can see the corresponding gray no drive areas. For some reason, I'm not showing the second video in real time. Those gray regions change. I want to make sure I get to one more topic which is how do we use all these ideas to increase the complexity in the interactions, especially when we have mixed human-driven vehicles and robot-driven vehicles. And it has been well documented that robot cars get confused when they have to negotiate driving situations with human-driven vehicles, with human drivers. They simply don't understand the human drivers. So what can we do to advance that idea? Well, here is the primary situation we are interested in, and that is taking unprotected left turns. We can model these situations using social dilemma. And so here the question is, for the black car, that's the incoming traffic, will that car slow down to allow the blue car to make the unprotected left turn or not? And in the top row, you see a situation where the black car slows down so that the blue car turns. In the bottom row, you see a situation where the black car does not slow down. And so knowing whether the car is more likely to slow down or speed up is going to increase the confidence in the prior for the blue car, for the acting car, and also adjust the control system accordingly. So what kind of progress can we make in this direction? Well, we can look at a metric from the socio-psychology literature, and this is the social value orientation, which measures human preferences in social dilemmas and can map these preferences mathematically on a circle via an angle. So we can measure people's personalities as individualistic or social or altruistic in terms of an angle that that measures the difference between the reward to self and the reward to others. And so using social value orientation, we can help increase the capabilities of the vehicle. So what does that mean? So let's consider a very simple case. How would you split $100 with a stranger? Well, one option is to keep $0 and give everything away. So this would make you an altruistic agent and give you an angle of 90 degrees. You can split 50-50, and then you're pro-social. That means that the angle is 45 degrees, or you can keep everything. This makes you egotistic, and that that allows you to keep all the funds, and then your angle is zero. So we can take this insight and map it onto computing a dilemma, a social dilemma for driving. And that allows us to differentiate between altruistic drivers and egotistic drivers and adjust our control system accordingly. We have three steps for our approach. The first is the social value orientation modeling from social psychology. The second is we set up a best response game where each agent maximizes its individual utility and compute the Nash equilibrium. And then we use inverse reinforcement learning, and we calibrate rewards using real data sets like the NGSim data. So I'm gonna speed up through this because I'm almost out of time. But the point is to create a joint reward weighted by the SVO, and then to compute utility over the time horizon and find the control that maximizes utility according to this SVO. And that allows us to differentiate between driving situations where we have altruistic other drivers and egotistic other drivers on the road. And so here is an example of implementing this, where in red we have the AV, in blue we have egotistic vehicles, and in pink we have altruistic vehicles. The nature of these vehicles is measured directly by observing the scene. And we can have, move to the next one. We can have egotistic merges. So here the red vehicle has to wait for the egotistic pink vehicle before the vehicle can merge. And similarly, If the pink vehicle is pro-social, the pink vehicle will slow down and make room for the red vehicle to merge. So it is interesting to note that we can compute the SVO in real time. And here's an example where we are using the NGSIM dataset, and we are showing two cars, the green car and the purple car, and we're showing their SVO estimates in the circular visualization. And so given this, what this means is that first we can calibrate what parameters look like for real driving situations. And then we can integrate this idea into motion planning systems that improve decision-making and prediction. So in fact, we have shown in our research that estimating the driver SVO improves trajectory predictions by 25%. And this in turn improves the safety and the capabilities of autonomous driving. Let me conclude by saying that with respect to deploying autonomous vehicles today, we have solutions that work at low speed in low complexity environments. But the advent of the kind of ideas that we are pursuing and many other people in the community are pursuing will lead us to being able to handle increased speed and complexity, and even enable mixed human-driven, robot-driven road situations. My own aspiration is for a future where our cars become self-flying, so that we can end up with environments that are wide and safe, and we don't have to be stuck in traffic. With this, I'm going to stop sharing and see if we have, I think we have time for just a couple of questions.
We do. Thank you, Daniela. That was for a terrific talk. If you have a question, please feel free to unmute and ask Professor Rus.
This is Shankar. Can I jump in?
Yes, please do.
Daniela, wonderful talk. On that last piece of your talk with the SVOs, what is your sense about the sort of the scalability? It's certainly a decentralized scheme, right? Yeah. And so what happens when large numbers of these agents follow the strategy? What is the group behavior like?
Well, I think that this models well the human behavior. So scaling wise, we have shown that we can apply the method in heavy congestion in simulation through the NGSIM data set. I will tell you that-
But the question is, analyze, okay, go ahead.
Finish. Yeah. So one limitation, if you want, is that in fact, the SVO is estimated fairly locally for a short time horizon. And so we have not yet tackled what happens when you have when you want to make longer term predictions. So instantaneously, you can look at what is happening around you and make a decision. But we may want to consider this idea for a longer time horizon.
That's great. So but where I was going was, your colleague, Kathy Wu, she has conjectured that a few sort of disciplined drivers can dramatically increase the throughput on roads. That's her sort of short version. And so I'm wondering if you were to do sort of even with the myopic, I think even with the short time instant that you do, what happens to throughput and what happens to the behavior of large ensembles? That was the question, really. Or what is your guess?
So my guess is that we will have interesting behaviors that in some sense map onto what we observe in human-driven systems. But what you have highlighted, Shankar, is an important next technical question. So I would tell you that, in fact, I drive in heavy traffic a lot in the Boston area, and I concur with Kathy's observation. In fact, the level of traffic can change from flowing to not flowing if you have just a few knobs. So like you remove a small number of cars from the road, it's a problem. or you get some cars to behave in a more selfish way, slowing down when they don't when they shouldn't slow down, and that creates congestion. Very interesting situations that we should try to solve from a control theoretic point of view.
We'll reach out to you. You know, I'm also working with Asu and Sarab on this, so we'll reach out to you. They're all your
let's collaborate. Yeah. This sounds like this would be a fantastic outcome.
Yeah, I think
this workshop,
wonderful talk.
For me as an individual.
Yeah. I'll wait till others ask questions. I won't hog the time, so I'll go off here.
Maybe we can take questions during the panel.
Yeah, we're pretty much on time, out of time, let's say here. So thank you again, Daniela.